Let's take a look at the big story today, the massive protests that were organized by Dalit groups, which saw huge disruptions across seven states and protests that also ended up turning violent as a result. Take a look.
Gunshots and killings in Dalit protests in Madhya Pradesh centered in Gwalior, Morena and Bhind. In Alwar in Rajasthan, a policeman opened fire once, aiming at torso level. Elsewhere, one person died in police firing on a mob which was trying to set a police station on fire. Trains, highways, traffic in cities, all disrupted. With some of the most disadvantaged, like these pushcart vendors in Devas in Madhya Pradesh, bearing the brunt.
We are in Bhopal, capital of Madhya Pradesh, and you can see the protesters there, and violent protests also erupted in Gwalior, Bhind, Morena, Sagar, Balaghat and Satna districts in support of Bharat Bandh, called by the Dalit organization across the country against a recent Supreme Court ruling allegedly diluting the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe prevention of atrocity act 1989.
And it was not just in these two states. Dalit groups of youth, teachers and other associations, as well as the BSP in some parts, came out to protest. Delhi, Uttar Pradesh, Gujarat, Punjab, Bihar all saw protests which hit daily life. In several places, there was violence. In Meerut, another is critical after being allegedly shot by the police. Azamgarh too saw violence and a narrow escape for passengers of this government-operated bus.
आरक्षण और दलित एक्ट के मामले को लेकर के पूरे उत्तर प्रदेश में जो प्रदर्शन हो रहे हैं यह उसी का हिस्सा है. लखनऊ में यहां पे गांधी जी की मूर्ति और अंबेडकर जी की मूर्ति के पास ये आंदोलनकारी यहां पे जमा हुए हैं.
हमारी पूरी संवेदना अनुसूचित जाति, जनजाति और वंचित तबके के सभी नागरिकों के प्रति है. कोई भी ऐसी स्थिति कोई भी किसी भी स्थान पे न पैदा करें जिससे कानून व्यवस्था की स्थिति बिगड़ती हो.
लास्ट मंथ द सुप्रीम कोर्ट रूल्ड दैट देयर कैन नॉट बी एनी ऑटोमेटिक अरेस्ट अंडर द एससी एसटी एट्रोसिटीज एक्ट एंड अलाउड एंटीसिपेटरी बेल, स्टेप्स दैट आर सीन एज अ डाइल्यूशन ऑफ एन एक्ट मेंट टू प्रोटेक्ट दलित्स, ट्राइबल्स एंड अदर्स.
द सेंटर हैज आस्क्ड फॉर अ रिव्यू. द क्रक्स ऑफ सेंटर्स पॉइंट इज that the top court's verdict on 20th March would deprive the members of the SC and ST community their legal rights guaranteed under the Constitution. That the facts show weak implementation of law and not its misuse. And finally, the judgment must be reversed to protect the SC and ST communities under Article 17, abolition of untouchability.
The discrimination of the Dalits is becoming an issue. For pure political purposes, it was our government which ensured that the very respectable political leader was also a Dalit become the president of India.
केंद्रीय सरकार को दलितों में पिछड़े हुए वर्ग में गरीबों में कोई रुचि नहीं.
इसको दाखिल करने में काफी समय लगाया है और यदि ये समय से दाखिल कर देते तो शायद जो दलित और आदिवासी समाज के लोग हैं उनको आज भारत बंद करने की जरूरत नहीं पड़ती.
However, the ruling BJP Dalit MPs echoed the anchor being seen on the streets and wanted the government to be more responsive.
Recent judgment with regard to Prevention of Atrocity Act is a precipitating factor. There have been other regions also in the past. It's accumulated anger.
Shops vandalized, buses and vehicles torched, police stations attacked and trains stopped in their tracks. Ironically, this widespread violence across North India was from states that actually record the highest incidence of crimes against Dalit. With Kamal Khan in Lucknow, Anurag Dwari in Madhya Pradesh and A. Vaidyanathan in Jaipur, Harsha Kumari Singh, NDTV.
Well, lots to talk about tonight, and let me go straight across to our panelists this evening. And first, I'd like to go across to Professor Vivek Kumar from the Jawaharlal Nehru University Department of Sociology. And Dr. Vivek Kumar, explain this to us. Is this just about the Supreme Court ruling, or is this much more than that, and why has it then boiled up to this point now?
I think you have rightly said that we should not reduce it only to SCST Act. I think there is a long story, and specifically I'll go after the formation of this government 4 years for so that from Rohit Vemmula onwards, their tallest of the taller women leader were abused. Even Babasaheb's name is not being spared, and you see how the reservations in universities has been scuttled. Now it will be department wise. Earlier it used to be university. As atrocities, 111 atrocities per day. This is the data. Two Dalits are murdered and three Dalit women are raped. Now, if you go by history, Dalit movement has never been so violent. I can vouch for with my research.
Were you surprised?
Yes, of course. I am intrigued. I'm really pained because I've never seen from 1848 onwards Dalit have, you know, humongous movements of Periyar, of Phule, Sahu, Babasaheb Ambedkar, Kanshiram, Mayawati. They have all gone in the movement, but it has never been violent. And that too at a pan-India level. There have been protests in different other parts of the country also. Violent is only in the seven states which you are showing, but it is a pan-India phenomena. So I am intrigued that how much you have pushed to a particular community, the most despised, excluded and depressed, that they have come to this level and they are asserting themselves in this way. I can never imagine that this can be only to SCST Act.
And yes, and so as you say, this is not just about one issue. And I'd like to go to Mr. Udit Raj, who is of course a Dalit MP belonging to the BJP in the Lok Sabha. Mr. Raj, I saw you there talking to my colleague Sunil Prabhu earlier today, and you said something similar to what Dr. Vivek Kumar is saying. You also said that this is also a protest because a lot of issues have accumulated. Are you worried, Mr. Raj, that politically this puts the BJP in a very difficult position?
Let me tell you, this is unprecedented. One could never imagine that Dalit protest across the country will be so effective, and somewhere it had become violent also, which we don't support. There is no room for violence in the democracy. But let me tell you, it's not one incident, that is the SCST Act. Otherwise, this much of anger, it could have not been there among Dalits. For 15-20 days, I've been watching on Facebook and WhatsApp being circulated that 2nd April is a Bharat Bandh. I asked several leaders also in the parliament also who had given this call, and no specific person was named that who is leading it, and that shows that too much of anger there. And I tell you, small organization, medium organization, bigger organization. Yesterday I was in Cochin, they asked me, they were central government employed, that are we participating in Bharat Bandh? They were also equally conscious of it. It's unprecedented. And at some point of time, if the call for Bandh was given, then it was limited, maybe in Maharashtra in some particular pocket, but across the country, unimaginable. And Supreme Court judgment, the other judgment which scuttles reservation in colleges and universities, that is also a factor. And privatization, I tell you, the core of the heart, core of Dalit think, if you check it, if you go in and introspect it or look into this, they are basically against privatization. They are angry because there is no recruitment. Because what happened is that reservation in job is a lifeline for Dalits. Otherwise, where is the other avenue available to them? They are not in industry, not in media, not controlling market economy, export, import, or land, etc.
It's very important.
This is the only
what you're saying is very, very important, because you are an important member of parliament. you're part of the ruling party, and when you raise these issues with your party leadership, why what did they
you
say?
Are talking to you are talking to a Dalit leader. You are talking to Dalit leader. I have been fighting for 20 years, and you, of course, party, there are enough spokesperson in the party.
But what did the party leadership say to you? When you took these issues to the Prime Minister, when you took these issues to the party president, what was their response? Do you feel that they have not really understood why this is happening, in your honest assessment?
We 15, 16 MPs, including Paswanji, met Prime Minister on 28th of March and apprised about the situation. And then, of course, Honorable Prime Minister says that matter is being examined. And, of course, it was not late. And now the government has gone in a revision petition. So what happened that the government is all sympathetic. There have been various programs for the employment of Dalit, whether Stand Up India or Mudra Loan or Dalit Hub. Many attempts are being made to uplift them. But definitely, policy of privatization and downsizing of the government.
So you believe that they gave you a sympathetic hearing? You believe that the Prime Minister gave you a sympathetic hearing? Yogendra Yadav, both what Udit Raj and Dr. Vivek Kumar have said is very, very important.
Yes.
Firstly, about the scale of the protests. Did it surprise you, Yogendra Yadav, just the scale of it today and just how big it was? And as Udit Raj says, there's no specific leader. It's just a whole bunch of people that have different organizations that came together.
Absolutely, Nidhi. And that is where probably the significance of what happens today lies in. Everyone thought this is one more Bharat Bandh, and Bharat Bandh, as you know, in most political cases happens for a few hours, it's not a very big thing. So the fact that something like this happened, that it happens across so many states, not being guided from the front or from the back by any one political party, and the sheer ferociousness in some places, that's really very, very unusual and indicates a new phase of Dalit movement, Dalit presence in the country. It could be, as Vivek Bhai says, because of the patience has run out from the Modi government and what it has not done. It could also be because, in addition to that, Dalit activist today feels much greater confidence, much greater ability to put their viewpoint across, as we have seen in today's television discussion. You know, you would not have had a discussion of this kind 10 years ago. So we have a new kind of confidence and assertion. That is what is leading to it. Having said this, I should say, and I'm sure both the colleagues there would agree with me, that no violence can be accepted or condoned. Nothing that we say should be seen to be condoning any violence, especially because not just the death of human beings, also arson, which is damaging the state property in the last instance. Secondly, nothing that happens today, violence included, should take our attention from the basic question that is being raised. Basically, it's not merely about the technicality of one Supreme Court judgment. It is mainly about exclusion from the system of criminal justice. Here is a large community which should be the principal beneficiary of the criminal justice system. The justice system should come to their defense, who feels they are not getting that benefit. They also feel excluded from all the top positions. It should be noted that we do not have a judge from the Dalit community in the Supreme Court. I mean, normally it should not matter, but a community which feels so completely excluded, they do not see any presence at the top. This is bound to aggravate that sense of exclusion. So let us not take our attention away from that fundamental question.
What you said about, you know, today people speaking out and the protest taking a new turn. Hitesh Jain, as a member of the BJP, How do you sort of look at these protests today and the voices coming in from within your own party that are saying that this is unprecedented, that it shows a lot of anger, too much anger, as Udit Raj put it, that has built up over a period of time?
Udit Raj also mentioned about the fact about the flagship program like Mudra Yojana and the Stand Up India. Now, what was the attitude towards the Dalit? You keep them treated as an employee, keep them forever as a servants. They have to only look for the jobs. From when you look at the schemes that have been initiated, even Udit Raj acknowledges these schemes are aimed towards empowering the Dalit community. That is point number one. Second point, if you look as far as the Supreme Court is concerned, the government has filed the review petition, and in the review petition, the Supreme Court has clearly, the government has clearly stated as to what is the view of the central government on this issue. And about the violence, the previous person was speaking that this is unprecedented and all. I mean, those who live in Bombay are reminded about the Ramabai colony riots and what had happened, and the same kind of protest, and how many people had died in the firing during that time. So it is not something that, this can be called an unprecedented. There are precedents in the past. But I want to make a very important point. In 1989, VP Singh government came with the act to protect the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe against the oppression and the kind of problem that was facing. Now, why was the act framed by the government then in 1989? Because of the oppression of 42 years. If you look into the act, it clearly stated and narrated about the instances about how the Dalits were being oppressed. And who was ruling for 42 years? It was the, we all know the answer, who was ruling for 42 years, and they continue to oppress them.
But
and then
Mr.
for
Jain,
them, they are like
Mr.
political
Jain.
Vultures. For them, Dalit, they do not believe in the
but
issue of empowerment of Dalit. But they just believe in
I'm
dividing
you,
the people on the lines of the
past. You heard the part that Udit Raj said about Mudra and everything else, but you kind of missed the entire first part where he talked about why Dalits are angry today. What about that? Why are we seeing these protests at such a huge scale across all these states?
Well, two answers. There can be some cases where I think we will have to go. The message for us is that we have to go down and educate them about the programs that we have taken for their benefit, their holistic development. The fact that how we believe not in the lip service but in actual service, we need to communicate to them much better. We need to communicate them much better.
Who are you?
And second thing is, there is this organized.
Who are you?
There is this organized
protest.
Just
stop this patronizing tendency. This is what we hate. We hate this patronizing tendency. You cannot represent us. We will represent ourselves.
Why are
we are fighting ourselves.
Why
you
are
you cannot
shouting?
Send a spokesperson today also. You as a Jain are representing Dalit. This is we don't like. And I absolve the Congress person. At least there was a spokesperson. There was a home minister. There was a railway minister from Dalit community. There was a Lok Sabha speaker from Dalit community. There was a culture minister from Dalit community. You cannot even send a minister today to defend. You do not have a, BJP doesn't have a even cabinet minister to defend today. This is what is patronizing, and this is what patronage you want to give. This is 21st century, 70 years of democracy. Democracy is right. You cannot represent. That's what I want to say.
Listen, gentlemen, if you have done...
You have so much of arrogance, you don't even know
who's
my name.
Who is the President of
Mr.
India?
Jain,
who is
I
the
am
Prime
Vivek
Minister
Kumar,
of India?
Professor Vivek
and what
Kumar.
Happened? Who defeated Baba Sahib Ambedkar twice?
Defeated
Do I
is
need
gone
to remind
story.
You? Whether they gave
also,
the Bharat Rattna
have
to Baba Sahib Ambedkar.
They have made a president of India also. They have made a president also.
What happened about the Hindu mill
also.
For 15 years?
Did
they construct
also.
The, they construct the monument for
they
Baba Sahib?
They have made vice-chancellor. They have made UGC chairman.
For 15 years, who
they
did?
They have made members of the planning commission. What have you done in 5 years? Not even one person is there. There are no vice-chancellors now in Central University from the Dalit community. What are you talking?
No, who is the president of India?
They have already made it in 1990s itself. What are you talking about? They made K.R. Narayanan long
back. Who's the Prime Minister
you
of India?
You are intimidating them.
No, who's the Prime Minister of India?
Prime Minister of India? Are you ready to say that? Are you ready to say that on
he
the
He belongs to the backward caste.
Are you ready to count the caste of the Prime Minister of India? Mr. Jain, are you ready?
I will absolve well, you.
You are the one who is bringing. We do not believe in this kind of politics. You are the one who is believing. You should know
you
who are the president and the prime minister of India.
You
we don't crowd
now.
On the caste basis.
You said it just now. Who is
we do not get into this caste business.
Now you
for you, you only your only agenda is to divide. Stop dividing. Nation is looking
no,
at you.
Won't
the educated community do not
you
represent
no
such kind of views. Yours
Dalits.
Is the most dividing. You also support
themselves.
The political vulture. You support the political vulture class
okay,
of the community.
One second. Before I come
no,
to
no.
You,
for you.
One second.
For you, the empowerment doesn't matter. For you, the steps taken doesn't matter.
It
you
doesn't
only
matter.
I think what Professor Vivek Kumar didn't like
in 1989, why was the law implemented?
Is that you were saying that we'll have to educate them about what we are doing for Dalits. I think he took offense to that and saw it as patronizing.
I'm not saying educate. We have to say,
that's
I'm
what you
saying
said.
That we as a party, we need to communicate. That we have done this much for the that so government is
now
doing and
language.
It will continue to do. This is the government for the scheduled caste, for the scheduled tribe.
Okay, Sudhindra Kulkarni.
If he doesn't listen properly, it is his problem.
Okay, one moment.
Without listening,
before I get to the Congress,
Javi.
Sudhindra Kulkarni, you had a contrarian take on this, which is why I thought it was interesting to listen to what you had to say. You felt that the Supreme Court ruling actually was not unfair, that it was actually very fair to prevent misuse of the law. But as you can see, Mr. Kulkarni, this debate and this protest is much beyond what has happened in the Supreme Court. This is clearly something that goes beyond that. And as a political commentator, as someone who watches Indian politics so closely, what do you then see the repercussions of this being?
You know, I am a minority voice on this panel discussion. I fully support the Supreme Court ruling and I oppose the Bharat Bandh today. And I especially oppose the very large-scale vandalism and violence that has taken place in order to make Bharat Bandh look successful. I am second to none in condemning violence and atrocities against the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. These are a blot on Indian society and especially on Hindu society. Nevertheless, let us be very clear that the Atrocities Act is being misused to a fairly large extent, and the government's own data shows that the misuse is to the extent of about 15-16%, and in about 75% the cases end up in acquittals. Now, in the cases where it is misused, who is the victim? Don't they have any protection under the law? Is the constitution not meant for them? Let me tell you that Article 14 of the Constitution says that every Indian citizen, irrespective of caste, community, etc., is equal before the law. Now, when a particular law is being misused,
okay.
I feel, and I have catalogued so many cases of misuse. You know,
okay.
I am from Mumbai. I can recount so many cases of misuse, and I have seen how the victims have suffered.
You have a very
now, don't
interesting
they need
take
protection?
On this. You have a very.
Now I'll give you one more example
so
before you know.
One
Nidhi,
moment, Mr. Kulkarni.
Please
let
listen
me
to
just
me.
Take, let me
you
just
know,
take.
You are talking about all these protests. Last year there were huge
Mr.
protests in
Kulkarni,
Maharashtra by the Maratha
Mr.
Kranti
Kulkarni.
Morcha. Much bigger protests.
What are you saying, Sudhindra Kulkarni? It is all India. You are saying Maharashtra is all India.
Don't interrupt
me.
I did not interrupt you, my friend.
What do you think of Sudhindra Kulkarni's contrarian take to this? One moment, Mr. Kulkarni. Because he says he doesn't justify a violent protest.
The Atrocities Act.
Okay, and he believes the Supreme Court was acting in the interest of everybody. One moment, sir. Let me get Javir.
What he has.
One moment, sir. One moment, Mr. Raj. One moment. Yeah.
370.
Sir, one moment.
Nidhi. Yeah.
Since this is the season of distortion of history for your viewers, the 1989 Act was not brought by VP Singh. For God's sake, it was brought by Rajiv Gandhi's government. This is a recorded fact. Point number one. Point number two. Today's protest is outcome of Modi government's anti-Dalit policy, anti-Dalit mindset, derogatory remarks against Dalit and rising atrocities. Did the BJP government tell the Supreme Court every day 6 Dalit women are raped? If does, that does not invoke a protest, I don't know what will. Did the BJP tell the government since they have come to power, they have drastically reduced the SC-ST sub-plan? Did they tell the government that 8,000 crore of scholarship fund compromising on the future of 51 lakh Dalit students and 21 lakh ST students have been compromised by this Modi government? No. Did they tell the court that Mr. Mohan Bhagwat believes that he does not believe in reservation anymore? I don't know about that factum either. Now let's take the wind out of the sails. Mr. Jain was saying the government has done many things. It's classic case of operation successful, patient dead. The government refusing to see the reality is the biggest dangerous thing you can do to a cause. Now the government, why did they wake up so late? If they could have announced the review petition to on the day on 20th March, the situation would not have escalated. The government could have said, we will bring a bill in the parliament overturning the Supreme Court judgment. Does any leader worth his name can commit on your show from BJP that they will bring a law bill to overturn Supreme Court judgment? No. Third, you are asked a very pertinent question. When they raise a protest, what does Mr. Modi say? The Bharatiya Janata Party MP Mr. Patole from Maharashtra, he came and gave a statement on record. Then whenever we raise the issue of OBCs with Mr. Modi, he is not interested. Now, you said farmer and Dalits. There is a third segment, students. Which section of the society today is not protesting?
That's
students, Dalits, farmers, traders, everybody.
So I want to ask Yogendra Yadav, politically, I'm coming back to the political question. How much of a setback does it then become for the BJP, which relied so much on getting Dalits on board and that they would be very crucial for 2019 as well? How does this affect their electoral prospects?
I think we've seen something significant today. But before I answer, I just wanted to say something about Mr. Sudhindra Kulkarni, whose contrarian view must be heard carefully and respected. All I want to do is to remind him, number one, that everyone on this panel has opposed violence. I specifically said violence must not be condoned. And second, on the question of misuse, yes, Mr. Kulkarni, as you know, Dowry Act is misused. As you know, Domestic Violence Act is misused. The only question is of balance. On balance, you have to see whether the misuse overshadows the benefits of that particular act. And it's not just the technicality of the Supreme Court thing. Here is a situation where a community feels that they are